No, that wire goes there. That wire goes there. There it is. Perfect. Hi, everybody, and welcome to the
Part two.
No, no, it's like that never happened. You all had a fever dream that was us doing a live stream. Yeah, it turns out that if somebody could request to our IT department that we need a an uninterruptible power supply here, because we got a power surge on the PC, and the PC shut itself down, which has happened before, but is not common. So, you know, people are blaming the shirts. People are blaming the fact that you're playing a five-string bass.
People are blaming. You should just go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, this was a bad idea. So we're getting things back in order. But if you're just joining us, I know some people actually had some problems getting Stream to supply them with the stream, as it were. Here's what's going to happen. We're going to start over. We're going to not play the trailer again. Well, you'll see that again by the end. But we're going to sing a song from the top. That's one of three Earth, Wind, and Fire songs today. Oh, there we go. Yay!
Yeah.
All right, everything. The computer is starting to realize who is the true master. True master of our computer is Brian Pody. We're going to do this again. Now, do you want to change your mind? Because you had said, gee, I don't know whether to play lead or rhythm on this. And now...
I just forgot I went.
Can I tell you that there's a little kind of trilly thing at the beginning?
Yeah, there's a one-off intro guitar phrase that, you know, and it's got that little slidey bits, and then it never appears again.
And you'll be ready for it this time?
Yeah, I'll be ready for it.
How is it that you have
so... got all tanglemified.
I am all tanglemified.
No, that's me.
Nope, this is me.
Maybe we should just swap head.
Are you? Oh, you're sitting on it.
I'm sitting on it.
Don't sit on it.
Why not?
Hotsy. Yeah.
All right.
I don't know, because mine's... How come you have so little... Where are you tangled?
Look, everybody's different, Dan.
I understand. Oh, you've got some of those funky shoes, too.
Don't talk about that.
You've got toe shoes.
He's got toe shoes.
Yeah. Too late.
You don't have to tell the internet.
I told the internet. What are they going to do?
Just do... Look, these are my shoes. Show us your shoes.
Nope.
Show us your
shoes.
He's
not going to do it. Mm-mm. He won't do it.
All right.
His shoes
anyway,
have toes.
Thank you for joining our super professional weekly developer live stream for Rocksmith 2014. This is Brendan West. He's our special guest today. He does a lot of things behind the scenes that you are probably not familiar with. But if you have enjoyed the authentic tones in the game, those are all due to Brendan. And, of course, you have engineered recordings for us, and you worked on Rocksmith. You worked with Matt Montgomery on a lot of his stuff, on Versus Them stuff. You guys both did On Top of the World with Matt for the... Pretty things, petty
you
troubles.
Keep calling it that.
I keep calling it pretty things, and it's just like in my head
forever.
Well,
that's what it is. It's pretty.
It is.
Things.
They're so pretty. But if you've seen the video of On Top of the World, that's your studio slash home.
He's lurking back there.
Yeah. But don't forget, we can't hear you unless the microphone is anywhere somewhere near your mouth. He's an engineer, ladies and gentlemen, recording engineer.
I'm good at sound.
All right, so here's where we left off. Now that the computer is working again, we're going to try Sing a Song by Earth, Wind, and Fire. After this, we'll do our first giveaway from Ernie Ball. We've got some great bass stuff to give away that everybody but Brendan can win. Sorry. And we are getting some interesting questions about you. We will do some Q&A with him a little bit later in the show. So if you have questions, you can save them. Sit on them for a brief period of time, and we'll dig into them a little bit later in the show. So, Mr. Pody on the Wheels of Steel, take us there. Let's do...
Let's sing that song.
Hey, there it is.
We got past that tuna.
Yeah. Hey, Jared, you've been looking at the chat a little bit. Oh no, sorry, you don't have it right there. Has anybody noticed that we have new overlays yet?
Oh yeah, have you guys noticed that we have new overlays yet?
Yes, have you noticed that we have new overlays yet?
Oh, thank you very much. These are work in progress. We may tweak these a little bit, but we wanted
to
give
them
Yeah,
let us know what you think.
Give them a run through. It was the shoes. Now everybody's saying it was the shoes. You guys are all just looking for a scapegoat. What are you, the internet? Big Tony 47 says, I opened a new pack of Ernie Ball strings and had an insert for Rocksmith. That's how we get you. You may have noticed that if you buy a set of Slinky strings, sometimes there's a little flyer in there that says, do you know Rocksmith exists? And since you do, please give that card to somebody else who doesn't. Brendan looks like my luthier. LOL. Do you Moonlight?
I didn't know LO was short for luthier.
Yeah. That would be fun. Your banjo, Bisco Bid's banjo, had an insert for Rocksmith. I don't know why, but I'm grateful that the word is getting out there to people that would never actually know about Rocksmith otherwise. Certainly, you have seen the banjo stylings of Jared McAdams.
And if you haven't, you're missing out.
Yeah, there's a few on our YouTube channel on Ubisoft Studio SF. A few of just little snippets of your holiday jams.
They're delicious.
They are. Your holiday jellies are even better. Yeah, I'm good at the dad jokes. Don't worry.
A lot of people asking about the new shirts.
I don't know what you're talking about. This nice red shirt that's showing up orange? We do not currently sell Rocksmith t-shirts. It's a fairly common question. We don't sell them because there is actually a fashion line in New York City named Rocksmith. So that's a point of contention. We can't sell Rocksmith t-shirts because there already are Rocksmith t-shirts.
Oh, I wasn't supposed to wear my shirt, was it?
No, you're fine. You're wearing the classic style Rocksmith t-shirt. No, don't take off the shirts. There will be no taking off of shirts today. But the rest of us have some new t-shirts because we did a little in-house order just for things like this so that we could... Because the branding that you see down there in the corner, you know, if you just follow my hand all the way to the corner of the screen, then, yeah, obviously, we needed more logos everywhere. How you doing?
That
feeling
lead chart
good?
Yeah, that's hard. Brutal.
That one's probably the trickiest one of the pack, right?
Yeah.
That's what we had
agreed.
Nothing
repeats.
Oh, great.
So, again, you're welcome for making it impossibly hard. I could have made it simpler, but it wasn't what he played, and, like, I was really going for note for note,
something
gesture
accurate.
For gesture.
Yeah.
Exactly what he did, and man.
Now, you do occasionally make judgment calls where it's like, well, there's two ways to play this. I'm going to go for the slightly easier one, right?
Yeah, but I feel like that does kind of a disservice to it. I mean...
I think we make a judgment call when it's literally going to never be fun.
Yeah.
Right.
And the thing is, like, you could, for the person who wants to learn how to play little funk riffs, if they want to go into Riff Repeater and isolate any one of these phrases and say, okay, what's he doing rhythmically? Because there's, like, a lot of offbeats, a lot of fret hand mutes, and you can start to learn each one and then, like, figure out, okay, that's the general feel. But
bless you, Jerry.
He wasn't thinking literally, okay, I'm going to play this off 16th, this off 16th,
right.
That kind
it's
of thing.
Just, it's in
just
the moment.
It's all feel. Good luck.
Yeah, man. yeah,
the rhythm part is the piano part, like I said, plus some synth stuff. And I think that's a lot more approachable. Yeah. And that seems more guitaristic in a way, but it's...
Sure.
That's a rhythm path for you. Mm-hmm.
Cool.
Yeah, I actually wanted to. You want to can you pull up the rhythm path real quick so I can just show off Brendan's cool tone? You are amazing.
Look at this.
Yeah, go into the short phrases.
Prose.
And then level that
short
up.
Short phrases got no reason to live, man.
And then just jump right into it. So Brendan did a cool thing. Like, I asked him to do this, like he did for Cold as Ice, is to make an octave lower bass synth. Tone. So you can play the synth line. It's
hey,
really
could you
cool.
show this on the big screen too? There we go. Thank you. So is this the rhythm part that you're showing now?
Yeah, that was the rhythm path. So I was just showing in the choruses, it jumps from the piano part to the synth tone where it's like that. Well, but yeah, we'd have to be in that phrase to keep hearing the tone. But, yeah, it was something cool I asked Brendan to do because I had a lot of fun with that Cold as Ice thing.
Oh, here you go. It's coming around again.
Yep.
And, you know, it's a lot of fun to do these kind of more far-out tones.
Pause.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's fun.
So well, all right. How'd you do it?
What's that?
How'd you do it?
Yeah, what are we hearing there?
What is that? I mean, it's an octave effect, obviously, to take the guitar down an entire octave, get it into the bass register. And then there's kind of an auto filter, which is sort of like a wah-wah, but coming more from the synthesizer end of filter design as opposed to the guitar pedal end of filter design. Although at this point, you could go to any music store and say, give me an auto filter pedal or a filter pedal, and they'll have a bunch of different options. But back in the day, guitar players kind of borrowed those filters from people who would have like a Moog synthesizer or an Arturia or something, like really, really early analog synth. Because they'd say, oh, look at this cool sound. Sounds like a quacking duck psychedelic thing. I want that. And they put it into their rig. And then eventually, you know, that became a very popular pedal.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's just kind of getting the synthy stuff that we have in Tone Designer and slapping it on guitar and seeing what it does.
Yeah. It's great. It's a lot of fun.
Excellent. Why don't you swap out?
I'm going to do it.
We'll keep Brendan. We'll do our first giveaway. And that is, of course, for the Ernie Ball Bass Pack. Here's everything that you could win. One person's going to get this, assuming the following things are true. One, you must be following our Twitch channel in order to be eligible to win this. And two, you must be willing to give us your name, your address, and your phone number. We don't use any of that information for evil. It's just so the mailroom can find you and give the information to FedEx or UPS as necessities bear out. But you're going to get two sets of bass strings. Slinky Cobalts and regular Cobalts. What's the difference? Slinkies have a higher output and a wider dynamic range on the Cobalt wrapped strings. So if you haven't tried them, perhaps this is your opportunity. Why not? They're free to you. Plus, you'll get the Wonder Wipes to keep your bass nice and shiny and clean. I'm a big fan of that. It will also keep your fretboard moisturized. And I'm a big fan of that because I've seen many a dry fretboard in my day. Also, a brand new Ernie Ball strap and a peg winder and some Ernie Ball picks, a dozen of their picks, but just three of the Rocksmith picks of which we spoke of earlier. But all that will be yours if you follow Black Widow 9's advice and do whatever she tells you to do to enter our raffle. And oh, looks like you're already doing it. Look at that. It's all down. Nothing but raffles, nothing but greed, greed, greed. But that's okay. Somebody's going to win. And yes, you can win even if you don't live in America. We've been shipping prizes everywhere. Even you. I've shipped prizes recently to Finland. Last week's winners were both in America, which was kind of odd. Usually it's the one of each. One person in continental U.S. and then one person somewhere over in the Europes or the Londons or something like that. And I did just send a package to the Ukraine. So we'll have to see if that works.
The Ukraine?
The Ukraine.
Wow.
And they got it. Which was curious because last time I tried to send something to Russia, it did not get there. And this time the person who was in the Ukraine said, I got the prize pack. Thank you so much. I signed up for Twitter just to let you know that it got here.
Oh,
so that was kind of nice.
Nice.
I like your orange t-shirt. Do you
mine
like my red
actually,
t-shirt?
Mine is actually orange.
Yeah.
And yours isn't. Yours looks way better. Yours on TV looks the color that mine is in real life.
It really is, yeah.
And
yours
kind of
yours on TV
and
looks looks like my house.
Yeah,
really.
Your house is ugly.
Thanks.
No, it's not. It's just orange.
It's just orange. It's a bright orange house.
I'd like to issue a correction before we go any further.
Oh, what did I say wrong?
Brendan, I don't get to see much of you. I'm so happy to have you here in the office today.
Was the correction that his name is Brendan?
Because earlier I said I hate you. But it's not Brandon.
I remember that you said that. I've been thinking about it since you said it, actually.
Yeah. What I really want to say, speaking of greed and Finland, is that last week, Brian and Greg somehow tried to convince me that Edvard Grieg is from Denmark. But he's not. He's from Norway. He's Norwegian, like I said.
Stop writing to me on Twitter.
I actually did get a message about that in the forum. Somebody said, hey, man, look, you.
Look.
And I knew what they meant. I read no further.
Right.
Musicology burn.
Yeah.
All right.
So we'll do more giveaways. Looks like they're wrapping it up. They've got they've still got some more stuff there. Hi, you're here for what is probably the most recognizable song of this pack.
Sure.
Although that's arguable because they were all really monster hits. But
yeah, Shining Star, people know that song. That song's
true.
All over the place.
But that's not what we're doing.
That's not what we're doing now.
We're doing September. September. Are you prepared
is
to
the
play
best
September?
Song. Yeah. Oh, I'm excited.
Yeah?
Yeah. I mean, I'm confused by some of the reaction I've seen out there. I mean, you know, sometimes we do packs or songs because the artist has a lot of very broad support, or sometimes we do it because they have very intense, hardcore support from a small group. And sometimes we just do it because the music is objectively awesome in every way. And that's the case here. It's just really, really good in every aspect.
But I don't want to learn things that I don't instantly recognize or that I didn't grow up listening
to. If you don't like
to.
This, you're bad at listening to music.
You have made mistakes and you must atone.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, actually, before we jump into this, how long have you been playing bass? Because I tried these bass lines and I'm not... Okay, yeah, I'm terrible at bass, but I'm getting better, like, incrementally. And you just dove into these and boom, and nailed it. So what the hell... What's your bass history here?
What is my bass history? My history is very bass. I started playing bass and guitar about the same time, about age 13. And on guitar, I was really into Green Day and The Offspring and like Weezer and power chord rock, and that was like it. And I sort of stayed in the world of power chord rock for a really long time. And with bass, I actually got a hold, I don't even know how I got a hold of this string bass, but I got a hold of this upright bass and just obsessed over it. And I was never any good, but when I finally gave up on being really no good at string bass, I had pretty decent chops for just playing electric bass, which is in many ways easier. It's different, but
sure.
Much easier, and certainly easier than the string bass that I was playing, which was a flaming pile of crap. It was not easy to play or fun to play. Did not sound good. And I really wanted to play a lot of music, and the town I was in, there were a ton of guitar players just everywhere. And so I just started saying yes to playing bass in bands. And I actually didn't really touch my guitar much for probably 4.5 years. And
wow.
Just bummed around, played bass in bands, made no money.
That's what bassists do.
Arguably, other than acquiring the skills to play the bass, made zero advancement in life in any way, be it financially, educationally. But I played a ton of gigs. And since then, I've just tried to keep my chops up, you know, and keep playing.
It sounds very, very nice.
Thanks.
And the fact that you were like, oh, this really difficult bass material? Oh, I want to come on and play that.
I do.
Sort of like, wow, all right, then you better come correct. And correct you are.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, it sounds very, very good.
Yeah, some of the fills are still too hard for me. But,
sure. Well, they're all personal expressions. You know, we talk about that a lot. We're like, well, they're tracked, but they were exactly what occurred to the musician to do in that moment.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
If you don't get all of them, that's not the end of the world.
Well, and this is Verdeen White, right?
I believe
player?
So.
Yeah, and he's such an iconoclastic player. Like, he just he doesn't play the way other people play, and so oftentimes you'll hear a fill that he does, and you think, oh yeah, I know what he did there, and then you sit down and try to play it, and you go, oh no, it's backwards and left-handed, you know, compared to what I thought it was. And I feel like players like that are just so interesting because they kind of challenge you to not get out of your square box pattern and just move your hand in a different way, or kind of open your ears up and hear something in a different way. And his bass lines are very much that. They sound really familiar, and they sound like other bass lines, but they are not. They are very specific displacements of rhythm and note choices, which are tweaked just enough to make it very much his thing.
Cool.
Yeah. And that's why I think it's nice that we do, you know, stick pretty close to what's actually happening there, because we could just say, oh, what he's really going for is this kind of stock
fill. This is the core.
But then you're not going to learn these cool arcane variations that really give it that extra little bit of spice.
Yeah. And everybody who came after him quotes him. I mean, he's in a kind of a small number of bass players who existed from like the early 60s to the late 70s, who just defined how the electric bass is played up until now. And you can really, like, almost any player who came up in the 80s, you know, yeah, they're good, they're creative, but you look at them and you're like, okay, you're kind of like, you're like Jaco plus Verdeen plus a little John Paul Jones.
Right.
You know, like, you can hear the influences.
You can hear the influences.
Because these players in the 60s and 70s were just, like, so iconoclastic and just so, like, defining of the sound, you know, and I feel like Verdeen is squarely in that group.
Cool.
And guitar had been around for forever that had been in jazz bands going way back.
Yeah.
And electric guitar even. But electric bass is really something that comes out of the 60s.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, yeah, that electric Fender bass, man. It
yeah.
just
yeah,
came,
the Fender
came
bass is what a lot of people would call it because it was unlike any instrument that people had used before.
Right. Yeah.
So it became known as the Fender. Carole Kaye, one of my favorite players,
yeah.
seeing her talk in interviews and on Wrecking Crew on that documentary, and she's like, well, yeah, I play Fender bass.
Yeah.
And it's not an endorsement. It's because the style was so different from upright string bass and the instruments that had come before. And there were trails to be blazed, and, mm-hmm. and Verdine White is one of those people that did that.
Yeah, I still play with people who will call this a Fender bass.
Really?
Because it's electric. If it plugs in and it's a bass, they're like, it's Fender bass.
It's a Fender bass. That's really funny.
That's the word they've been using for 60 years. They're not going to change.
Yeah.
So is there anything that you want to set up about September?
Well, you know, I'll just quickly say that a lot like Brian's chart on Sing a Song, there's the lead and rhythm are completely different. There's no overlap between them. The lead is a more literal interpretation of the prominent guitar parts in the song, and the rhythm is sort of borrowing from what's happening in the piano part and some other little guitar overdubs that happen from time to time and some other odds and ends. And I think that's the part I'm going to play. To me, I like that part a lot, even though it's not really the part that pokes out when you listen to the song. You know, there's that single note line that really kind of goes through the whole song, but I think one nice thing about this part is just kind of playing through the changes. It has a very cool chord progression, so I'm going to play that part.
Okay, play that part.
Yeah.
This is September by Earth, Wind, and Fire, part of the Earth, Wind, and Fire pack, which is available everywhere worldwide right now except for Xbox One. We're aware there's some engineering issues going on. We have figured out that it kind of wasn't our fault, but we are working with Microsoft to figure out how we can help them fix it. So thanks for your patience on that regard.
Oops.
This is that part where you play.
I was distracted by Greg.
Oh, Greg Barr has joined us because Greg Barr will be joining us.
I'll play that B string.
Greg Barr will be joining us for the next song after this one. Couple people noticing that September was pitch shifted just ever so slightly, but they noticed the difference. Why do we pitch shift songs? Because people don't like it when they're out of E standard A440. The original recording for this is a couple of cents sharp. It's like, what was it? A444, A445, something like that. But when we get permission, rather than make everybody retune, if it's something small like that, we ask the artist or the licensor, or both, depending on who owns the rights, if we can do that. And if they say yes, we do it, and that's what we did this time. So you do not have to retune for what is really a very small increment. Other times you will notice there's songs in our library that are to the true tunings of the recording, all the Hendrix stuff, for instance, because, you know, sometimes they say, no, please leave it as it is. And sometimes it's an artistic statement. Hey, Mr. Pody, could you close that mixer so he can see the whole fretboard? Thanks. We got multiple screens on our side. Black Widow wants to know why I'm sitting here so still. I'm storing up the funk, and I will dance later. I really wanted to just do the Philip Bailey stuff all throughout the stream, but we do have some more giveaways coming up. We'll give away some of this Earth, Wind, and Fire DLC on Steam at the end of the song. And then we've got some more goodies from Ernie Ball later on in the show. So if you just came for the free stuff, you're still in luck. And then you just stop. You're supposed to just play softer.
Fade out.
And fade away, yeah. That's lovely. Everybody was just like, oh my God, how, you know, what a great groove. And they liked your bass face too, by the way.
I've got a bass face.
Yeah. That's okay.
Yeah, I love that song.
Can't turn it off.
I love that G over A chord.
Yeah, it's awesome, right? Somebody.
Yeah.
And if you play, we've got a couple different cool voicings of the chord. One that's played down here, and another one that's played up here in the lead part. And I see a lot of people, and I see them play live, they'll play with that six. Both cool voicings. Yeah, it's fun. And then, yeah, and then going up, a lot of this playing with the 7-1.
That is fun.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Excellent. So, if you're good, and if you're good, we'll let you actually take a break while we show a very brief video. And we give stuff away. Black Widow 9 has codes for Earth, Wind, and Fire to give to you. If you are a Steam gamer, we have 5 sets of the codes to give, and so we'll do that giveaway now while you watch this success story. Spoiler alert, it's a success story about the 60-day challenge. We'll be back with the Backtrack Spotlight on Parliament and Greg Barr after this break. Thanks for tuning in, and thanks for sticking with us while things went a little bit haywire earlier. We'll be right back. Are you doing bass on...
So, gonna get my guitar out. I haven't seen this guitar. I haven't seen the guitar itself in like 2 years. It's probably been up here for about a year and a half. My name is Casey Coyman, and I'm 32 years old. Instruments growing up were very foreign to me. I went to a summer camp one time and they had a guitar class. I couldn't figure it out. To me, it just didn't make sense. And then I also got interested in other things. I mean, I was 12 years old and there were girls in the camp, so maybe I just took it to hang out with girls. I don't know. When I first picked up the guitar, I was nervous just to like hold the guitar in the first place. It's scary, because it's an instrument, and I feel that instruments, they have to be a part of you versus being something that's a set aside. And I feel like that is always scary to me, but when I plugged it into Rocksmith and I'm playing one note out of the entire song, I feel like it's not as daunting. It's not as scary. It doesn't have to be that to start. Hopefully after this process, though, I'll be able to pull it down and start jamming. So far, I'm enjoying everything about this game. I mean, I really enjoy the challenge of it, but also the fun of it, because it keeps you motivated to keep going forward with it. I recognized all the chords, and I was able to know what they were. My fingers couldn't move fast enough, but I know where they should have gone. And that's a positive. That's a positive thing. Get it? So yeah, I was working on specific songs with the software. I was working on Painted Black, which was awesome. My accuracy's up. You know, I just played this 94% accuracy. I feel like I've improved tremendously in comparison to where I was just 3 weeks ago.
I've been playing Rocksmith now for 45 days. It really followed my progression of improvement. So when I start playing a little bit better, it starts challenging me a little more. In one of the mini games, I just had the best score I've ever had, and that was really exciting for me.
I'm very happy with where I'm at, I'm very happy with the progress.
I've struggled with every other way, and I found this way to be the best. And that's like an honest fact. I pick up the guitar right now, I could play the riff from Rock This Way like that, you know, which is pretty cool. Rocksmith has provided me with a wonderful foundation to continue playing guitar. And that's 60 days. So the software actually progresses you faster than you think, and it's pretty amazing. We'll be right back.
Greetings, everybody, and welcome back to the Rocksmith 2014 live stream with real live developers like real life Greg Barr. Hi,
Hello,
Greg Barr.
I'm alive.
Yes. Thank you for wearing one of the cursed blue Ubisoft shirts. People keep saying
everyone would wear one of these. So
yeah, that's right. Well, you got some too.
I did. I left it at the office.
Oh, you are at the office.
Oh.
Oh, damn it. You could have worn it. It's all right. Anyway, thanks for sticking with us for the second half of our show. We've got two more song performances to go. We've got some Ernie Ball gear to give away, and hopefully somebody just won the Earth, Wind, and Fire DLC that we gave away. So, you know, you have your chance to do that. Every week we like to give away stuff because we know that's the only reason you tune in. Mm. You're not tuning in for us. In any case, we're going to do our Backtrack Spotlight. This is something we do every week. We pick a song that's already in the library, maybe one that you're aware of, maybe one that you're not aware of, and we get one of our musically inclined note trackers to actually explain the musical theory or the technique or sometimes the history behind the song so that you get to know that song a little bit better, even if you already know how to play it. And this week is a song that you said, I think I am more excited to do this song than I have for any song
Probably.
We've done on the Backtrack so
yes.
far. And this includes your own arrangement of In the Hall of the Mountain King that you explained
last week.
So I thought that was kind of interesting. Like,
this is much funkier. The bass line on this is much funkier.
So this is Give Up the Funk, Tear the Roof Off the Sucker by Parliament, which, I mean, when you talk about funk, and we are, these guys kind of, like, wrote the book. I mean, this is...
They definitely
quintessential.
Have their own brand of funk,
yeah.
for sure.
I'm a big fan of Zap.
That may be out of fashion.
You've
heard the new Bruno Mars song, right? The Uptown Funk. Zap all the way.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and that's what I said. I said to one of my friends, I'm like, I'm totally getting a Zap vibe. They're like, no, this is just James Brown kind of stomp.
Zap.
And I'm like, no, let me play you some bits and pieces of Doo-Wah Diddy.
Yes.
And Uptown Funk. And my friends went, oh, wow, you're totally right. Yeah. I was like, I win. Yep. I know music.
Yeah, Zap is awesome. I like Zap a lot.
But in any case, that's not what we're playing here today. We're playing Parliament. And, of course, this is George Clinton, one of George Clinton's bands. Mm-hmm. Like, I think there's 85, 86 people in this band at any given time. Bootsy Collins was the bassist for Parliament and for Funkadelic. And, of course, after a while, he just sort of mixed everything together and they became known as the P-Funk All-Stars. So you may have heard that in relation to this. But this is 1975. This is serious.
This was one of their biggest albums, I think. Probably their best-selling as well. Mothership Connection.
So what is it about, and I love the fact that you're going to play funk on the viola, on the hollow body.
This is my favorite bass,
It is a great playing bass, but it's the one thing I would not have thought to play on it was funk. What is it about this song that makes this one of your favorites?
The bass line is it's very unpredictable. You would expect it, you know, it's in E, and at least a lot of bass players are just like on the downbeat, just, open E. But he doesn't. He hardly ever plays any downbeats, and when he does, he'll play like a really small kind of high E up at the top. But it's not the main focus. All the focus is on the other beats that aren't the strong beats, all the weak beats and the syncopations and stuff, which makes it that much more funky and kind of a little
unpredictable.
Unpredictable. Yeah.
So I'm going to join you on rhythm guitar because there is no lead path. But that means that this is sort of a hybrid lead and rhythm at once. Like this chart is. It's pretty simple in that it's basically two riffs that repeat with some variations, you know, just little grace type things. And I'm really good at doing one of them, and I'm not really good at doing the other. So you'll see me screw this one up because I did not prepare enough for this. It's been one of those weeks. But in any case, this is available. Was this Rocksmith 1 DLC or Rocksmith 2014 DLC? Rocksmith 1. This is Rocksmith part of the... Oh, that's right. There was the Funk Pack. With... Good Times and the Rick James song.
Right. This was Kevin Cameron's song. Yeah.
Oh, was it? Mm-hmm. Ah, all right. Well, let's
Rest
do it.
In peace.
Let's do Give Up the Funk, Tear the Roof Off the Sucker. If you'd like to know more about what it is that makes this song so cool and funky and syncopated, go to our website, rocksmith.com, go to the forums, go to the DLC section, I believe. And it's in Backtrack Spotlight. You'll find Greg's write-up where he talks about the rhythm of this and how it all works together. So.
Thank you.
Sorry. What's the matter? Oh, does it not like that bass? That bass is not funky enough? Or is it too funky? Perhaps it is, in fact, too funky. We're gonna re-detect the song. So you may have seen this. We talk about this sometimes. This is the calibration. This is making sure that Rocksmith is calibrated to the pickups and the output of your guitar, so that when you are playing, it knows what it is. Obviously, the output of the Tobias is different. Different kind of pickups. Different everything. Oh, I'm totally... Yeah, my my guitar has decided to... We are! Hey, I'll give you... How about that? Hey, that might explain... that might explain everything. Hey, look, there's me! You're going to make us calibrate again, since I am now calibrated for his. Okay. You can do anything you want during that. You can make just total noise. You can play chords. It doesn't matter. It's just looking for the relative output of your pickups. Hey, hopefully this time it'll go much better for you. And thanks for making me have to play the part that I'm not terribly good at twice. I appreciate that. You would think I would get better every time I play it, but... Don't blame me, Brian Pody. You're our technical advisor, damn it. There we go. It's all part of actually playing guitar, is learning how to tune, and tuning when the game wants you to tune, and, you know.
And making sure your guitar is plugged in.
And making sure that if you have two cables, that they're labeled, like little flags that say one and two, and that you pay attention to who's doing what. Those are the things that you need to do. Anyway, here we go. Parliament, one more time. It's Thursday, isn't it? Things always go wrong on Thursday. Never could get the hang of Thursdays. Hey, there you go. Yeah, it's detecting now. Good for you. And the funny thing is, I love funk. I really don't want to disrespect the funk like this. And yet, I can't help it. To me, part of the trick is not playing the notes, but consistently, you know. Some people say funk is just repetitive, but you're building a groove. And in order to build a good groove, you've got to be consistent. So it's not what you're playing, or oh, I know those notes. It's the spirit with which you're playing them, and yeah, and how you're attacking them. I say this because I'm sure there's people in the chat room going, "That looks easy. How come Dan's screwing that up?" You have no idea how much I can screw stuff up. Bass chords are great.
Yeah. I don't really know what they are.
Funky. He says they're just tritones, aren't they?
Those are. There's a couple, like, triple tritones way up here.
A tritone?
Tritones.
Well, if at first you don't succeed, try tritone. Dad jokes, ladies and gentlemen. So tonight on the show, yeah, I'm going to go back to my David Letterman since David Letterman's not using David Letterman anymore. Hey, Rocksmith guy says, getting better. I guess thanks very much, Rocksmith guy. So in any case, hey, that was fun.
That was fun.
And I guess I didn't do too terribly bad. Well, I didn't do great.
Well.
I got 87%.
Yeah.
And before I came up here, I did 89. So clearly, my problem was what I'm calling the orange riffs. Well, yes, not only am I nervous, but there's that chorus riff, which is fairly easy, but it was the slides. Sometimes it slides up from 4 to 9. Sometimes it slides up from 1 to 9. Mm-hmm. Sometimes he throws in a little 4-6 riff in there, and you know, like it sort of changed every time that I did it. Yeah. And I didn't get any of them particularly right. So I was playing partial riffs. What I really should probably do is play it at like 90% in riff repeater, and get my fingers used to doing the basic pattern, and then start deviating from that pattern when it goes all the way up to 100.
Yeah, but the good thing about this is, like you said, it is only two riffs, and the bass is the same way.
Right.
There's the A riff, and there's the B riff. And
right,
that's pretty
and then it's just
it.
How you put them together.
Yeah, it's varied a little bit.
But. Yeah. Hey, kids, it's time for the Q&A part of the show, and that means we're going to bring Brendan back.
Yay.
Why don't you come on in, Brendan? And now, so if you're joining us late, or if you... Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean... If you haven't heard, Brendan is the guy that creates all of our authentic tones for the game, and we'd be open to your Q&A now if you have any questions about the way that he creates tones in the game, or questions about guitar effects in general. But I'll start off by asking you, what is the While we wait for the Twitch chat to catch up,
yeah.
What's the magic back end software that you use? I'm sure there's some mystical tool that's custom built for you, making the custom tones in the game mm-hmm. and everything. What does that look like?
Well, as it says in the credits, the audio engine is Wise for
right.
the game, and that's what hosts all of the guitar effects. But we did a lot of custom stuff in house to kind of wrench on Wise, basically to be able to get what is normally an audio middleware tool for normal video games to be able to work for a real time music game and actually do real time audio processing on the audio input. So it's definitely Wise, but it is a very special version of Wise.
Right. But for actually creating the tones
mm-hmm.
in the game, what are you using to do that?
Oh yeah, we just use Tone Designer.
You just use Tone Designer.
We just use Tone
Designer.
Which
you designed also.
Yes.
So
yes.
you designed Tone Designer and...
Well,
to be fair,
I designed the bits of Tone Designer. There are actually a lot of other really cool, hardworking people who did stuff like menu flow and saving and all
We'll be
that.
Talking about Nick Bernardi
yeah.
all day long.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, so when you actually sit down and go, okay, I need to reverse engineer this, say, Primus bass tone,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
To pick something that was probably fairly challenging.
Yes.
You're actually just playing with the same front end that you can use in the game that is Tone Designer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you want to call up Tone Designer? Really quick, I realize we can show people
yeah,
kind of...
Yeah, it's totally... It's identical. Obviously, we have a dev build of the game, so... When we save the tones, I have a file that users don't have access to, which we can then go and do some other tagging and things like that
sure.
too. But it all starts really with listening to the tune, and I kind of, I'll listen to a song and I'll listen to whatever mix that we were delivered, because sometimes there are different versions with different performances
mm-hmm.
and possibly different guitar gear. On a different performance or a different version of a song, but I'll listen to the version that we have, and I'll kind of make a guesstimation as to what I think it is. Sometimes it's really easy to tell.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes like there are
that's
certain,
a phaser.
Yeah, there are certain instruments and there are certain amplifiers that are very distinctive. And I would say like Fender amps and Telecasters in particular. Like they're a Telecaster sounds like a Telecaster. Period. It's very identifiable. If it's a Tele on the tune, I'd say about 80% of the time I know right away. And I'm like, okay, mm-hmm. cool, that's a Telecaster. So I'll actually grab a Tele at the studio, and I'll start there with the closest guitar that I have to what they're actually performing that guitar tone with on the original song. So I'll grab that instrument and then just kind of start diving into the amps and effects. I try to do a little bit of... I try to do as much kind of gear anthropology as I can.
Mm-hmm.
And that, is looking at books. There are some really great books often published by kind of famous mixer people who mixed famous artists, and they'll actually talk about the equipment that was used. Sometimes I'll look at internet forums, although that can be just as much misinformation or just as much guessing as actual solid information. And I actually do a lot of photo and video research to look at, this was recorded in an album around 1984. So let's look for the 1984 live tour. Let's see if we can find four or five photos. If I can find a bunch of photos of them playing live and they have the same gear, I'm going to say there's a good chance that's what they used in the studio. Not always.
Sure.
But I'll try to find something in Tone Designer that's similar to what I see in the photo and then start there. If it sounds bad, I throw all of that out and just start from scratch with something different, because
sure.
ultimately, obviously, the number one top priority is the player experience of the tune, actually like enjoying playing the song.
Sure.
But we also want to have some authenticity, and there's kind of like a fun just learning about what the different amps start to sound like. If you look at when the amp drops in, you're going to start to hear some common things. Especially we're looking at, I think, like a Marshall Plexi right now, or a JCM 800. It's an 800.
Yeah.
Totally. So like, it's got a sound, and you're going to see there's a certain type of song that's going to have this. That's going to be a certain
sure.
kind of hard rock, power chordy thing. These people keep using JCM 800s because that's just kind of this like rock guitar amp sound.
The classic rock distortion sound, it says on the screen even.
It is. It
yeah.
really is. So, you start to, after a while, you start to recognize that these amps have kind of a signature sound to them. We have a lot of different amps in... in tone designer, but they're grouped in such a way that you can see they're kind of grouped in similar groups with very similar names. So we try to give, you know, the different flavors, you know, like you've got all these Marshall amps and they're sort of like, you know, the Plexi and the 800 and some JVM stuff and in the DSL, they're all similar. You know, Marshall is really stuck with a certain voice to their
sure.
amp.
They're famous for it.
Yeah, but there's some nuance there. And so, you know, if it's obvious that a song was recorded with a Plexi, I'll load that up and use that. And if it's obvious it was recorded with something more modern, we'll try to find a modern equivalent that sounds good.
Sure. I have questions for you now.
Yes.
Specific questions from our audience. Bleezus says, do you have a favorite tone in the game? Is there one that you're really proud or that was really challenging that you you dialed in?
Man, it's kind of embarrassing, but to be honest, my favorite tone in the game is the lead path guitar tone, because every time I hear it, I just play the like
just the default tone.
And because every time I hear it and play the guitar through it, I just play the like one half of Van Halen songs that I know, because I don't know any Van Halen song all the way through.
Yeah, right. A lot of Panama.
Yeah, a lot of Panama. And you know, I don't know why. I mean, it's really silly. But I just kind of love that tone. And we also spent a lot of time on it because we wanted it to be something that was evocative of lead guitar and sort of introduces new players to kind of distortion and loud and what the electric guitar is about. But also we tried to make it kind of smooth and not too abrasive. Mm-hmm. You know? So we definitely spent a lot of time.
Sounds great on bass too.
It does. It does. It's kind of a great bass tone if you're into that sort of thing. But yeah, I really love that tune. That tune. Some of the Tom Petty tones I really liked because they're in this, I think, like this kind of wonderful guitar sound is that not quite distorted, not quite clean, compressed tone. And those are using an amp, which is very evocative of like a Vox or a kind of a British combo amp. And I just think that's like a great sound. I think that kind of like an amp pushed to the very edge of breaking up. It's not shreddy. You know, you can like back off the volume knob and clean it up a little bit. You can play lighter and you can get some distinction from it. But if you lay into it, it really sounds like rock and roll. Like when I plug into a real amp, that is where I go.
Right. You know, you want to be right on that edge.
Yeah, I don't go for the shred pedal. I try to find that nice, fun.
The metal zone.
Yeah, not the metal zone. Not the metal zone. I love the metal zone.
Yes.
But not the metal zone.
But not the metal zone.
Yeah.
Bleez has also asked, how long does it take to nail down a precise tone? Is there an average time that it takes you to dial in that sound that you're talking about? Because it sounds like the process itself is, part of it is intuition and part of it is experience and the skill of just training your ears to go, oh, that's this thing. But it sounds like you do a lot of research and you really do, like,
yes,
before you dial that in. Is this a couple of hours per tone for you, or is this a couple of days? Do you have to sleep on it?
I usually don't have to sleep on it, although that has happened occasionally. I mean, I'm definitely not going to spend 8 hours wrenching on a tone, because you'll just fry your ears at that point.
Right.
So I do try to mix it up.
The same.
Yeah, it's no good. So I do try to mix it up and work on a few at a time. It would be kind of meaningless to give an average, because honestly, I've had it take 15 minutes. There have just been times where I'm like, I know exactly what that is. It's identical to this other song. I'm going to go and get it, put it in game, test it. And just the actual making of the tone takes almost no time at all. And I've also had it take basically an entire day and be this really kind of like soul crushing, trying to find the right sound, especially with stuff that's really far out or uses unique effects. You know, just trying to find something that's going to be fun to play and sounds like the track and doesn't sound bad,
right?
Which is kind of a big thing. So there is no average.
There is no average. It's just whatever it takes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Bitspiel says, have you ever gone back to a song and revised the tones for that song? Now, I don't think we've ever updated any tones, but have you ever made a tone? Let me change his question.
Yeah.
Have you ever made a tone and then gone, oh, I found a better way to do it? Like, and then wished that you could go back and alter the tone. Have you ever?
Yeah. I mean, we came out of the gate in with Rocksmith too. I mean, you know, we were trying to get the game out and get it out on time and have it be really good. And I feel like, and I really dove into making the tones after the game was out. And I certainly feel like I've gotten better. So there's some stuff, you know, I'm sure there's some of those earlier tones that I probably go, oh, maybe I would do this differently. But, you know, you can really chase your tail trying to do that, because
sure,
one of the biggest thing that I do with these tones, it's easy to get a tone that sounds good with a guitar. And in the studio, I have like 9 guitars. And this is not you know, it's not like bragging. I'm not into having it's a bunch of instruments. It's actually really weird. Because like guitar collecting is other thing.
I don't think there's anything weird with that.
No, but you know, because I come from like this gigging background where I just had one instrument and you play it until you break it and then you buy another instrument at the pawn shop. But once I've got kind of the tone sounding good with the instrument that I think they played or something similar to what they played on the track, then I'm going to grab the polar opposite of that. So if I'm in kind of like Telecaster land, I'm going to grab like a Les Paul-esque guitar or like a hollow body humbucker guitar, throw it on the neck pickup and say, is this workable? And nine times out of 10, the answer is no. And so we do a lot of kind of streamlining and sort of compromise in the sound of the tone to make it so that, you know, if we're doing like a really high gain heavy metal song, obviously if you roll in with like a Les Paul on the like bridge position, you're going to say, yeah, this is like crunchy and perfect. This sounds exactly right. And if somebody who has like a Fender, like a Jaguar or something like that, like it has just single coils and it's really thin and bright, they're going to plug in and be kind of disappointed and underwhelmed. Right. And so we try to find a way to hook them up so that people with different instruments are not just getting the short shrift. From the sounds, and that's a very it's a difficult process because we don't want to compromise so much that we sort of lose sight of the point of the tone.
Sure.
And obviously if someone's like, I have this Les Paul for playing rock and roll, and then this rock and roll song comes down, they want it to sound perfect, so we try to find a happy medium there.
I have somebody, this seems more like a reason to try to get you to cry on camera than an actual question, but Porto Was Taken says, how was the Rage Against the Machine pack for you? There's a very distinctive guitarist with really insane tones, uses pedals and effects inherently in his sound, Tom Morello does. And here you are going, yeah, how do I do this?
It was definitely work because there were a lot of tones, but it was actually easier than we thought it was going to be because there was a very clear dividing line between here are sounds that we can make and then here's this other sound which is literally impossible to make. Like, you need exactly his stuff. It would be really difficult for a normal person with money to buy the pedals to make that sound, much less for us to model it in a game that's already out that has sort of like, this is what's in Tone Designer. Right. So I think we really tried to pick our battles there and just... you know, when we can't make the exact sound on the recording, then I think the focus becomes more on what's the player experience for what the note track is going to be. You know, so for whatever notes that are coming down the noteway, if there's some goofy sound associated with that because of guitar effects that we can't attain, then we just try to choose a tone that's going to make sense with those notes so you can hear yourself and also something that just kind of, you know, gels with the rest of the song. And that was actually, we thought it was going to be really hard, and it actually turned out to be fairly cut and dry for the Rage stuff. But I mean, obviously for those Rage songs, you know, I make the tones before the note tracks are made. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, there's probably, I think I made like 11 tones for each of those songs. And then ultimately what is chosen matches what's in the note track.
Sure.
You know?
Wow, crazy.
Yeah.
I don't want to go... I mean, we have a lot of questions, but I also know that like we're a little over time, and I want you to play on the last song.
Sure.
But what are the challenges making tones for acoustics or non-guitar instruments? That one comes from This Name Is Lame. There's a couple times... You know, I mean, this is designed for solid body electric instruments, and yet you've got things like Tom Petty where you hear 12 strings in the background and stuff like that. I think... is your mic on? Your mic is on, and
hello?
Somebody's breathing, and I'm like, who's breathing?
Oh,
and I think it's you.
Yeah. I breathe sometimes.
No breathing.
Stop the breathing. No, you have to keep that there, or else we can't hear you.
All right.
But, you know, sometimes you are asked to do weird sounds and stuff like that. Is that similarly a guessing game? Is that, like, how do you approach doing a 12-string acoustic, for instance, when you know that... Nobody, even if they had a 12-string, the game would not detect it because it's not built to detect a 12-string instrument.
Exactly. I mean, that's just it's a creative thing. I mean, because that's kind of a blank slate in a way, because it's like, okay, take this instrument, make it sound like this other instrument with the tools that we have available. I actually find those to be really fun. They're very challenging because it's easy to overprocess, and again, finding that compromise. To sound good with different instruments can be really tricky, but I really like it. I mean, I think that challenge is really fun, and I think the tones for acoustic instruments in particular have gotten more and more that we've really kind of like zeroed in on something that's pretty good, that's consistent, that works in game. And a lot of it has to do with the fact that acoustic parts are different often from electric parts.
Right.
Sometimes that's not the case, but oftentimes it's like open chords and they're strummed. And so finding the right volume balance is almost more the challenge than finding the right tonality, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Fair enough. There's a lot of other things just saying, will you confirm this artist is coming to the game? So-and-so
yes.
Confirmed. Yes. Your favorite artists?
Yes. All of them.
Sure.
They're coming.
Why not?
4 days, they will all be out.
Thanks, Brendan. Much appreciated. Let's get this man a bass and shut him up. So yeah, if you're up for the last song, let's see, Greg, don't go too far because you're on this song. It's Shining Star. Would you like the Les Paul for this one? Is this one good? Oh, I'm sorry. Here you go. And you've got a cable, so. Yeah, the cable switching. We'll get that one right this time. Everything pack confirmed. Yes, absolutely. Everything is happening.
But as Brian said last week, the week before, we're always, always trying. We're always trying to hook it up.
Yes.
We love you, and we want to hook it up. So just trust. There are so many discussions about hooking it up, and hooking it up is just such a huge priority.
Yeah, there's really, I mean, any artist you can basically think of, any major artist that you've ever seen anywhere on TV or on the radio, somebody who's inspired you to play guitar, there's a really good chance we have already reached out to them and asked, hey, would you like to be involved? And it does take a very, very, very long time for them to say yes or no.
Yeah.
Sometimes they do say no, at which point we generally go back to them later and say, how about now?
Yeah. I don't know if you ever tried to get a famous person to call you back, but it's,
no.
It's hard.
Yeah, it's so, you know, even though, yes, of course, we're offering them money and then they have the opportunity to get more famous and get more money based on everything that we do. You know, some people just don't want to be involved and that's their artistic choice. You know, that's okay. Hey, I don't want my music used in a video game. That's something that we sometimes hear. Okay, that's cool. If that's not what you want to do with it, there's nothing we can really do to change your mind about that. It's your artistic right to do that. But other people, even if they are interested, they're super busy, or maybe they need to have some more things explained, or maybe they're not the only person that owns the whole song. They have to say, well, I'm in, but maybe the other three people that own pieces of the song don't agree. That happens fairly often. There's a whole big article about this. I know Toy Machine has been basically spamming the chat room, but if you go to bit.ly/rsprocess, that will explain in a beautiful infographic some of the things that we face as to why certain songs are not in the game or certain artists are not in the game yet. But it doesn't mean that we've stopped asking. And in fact, right before the stream, we had another licensing meeting where we were talking about who we're trying to approach, what kind of songs we're trying to get in. Here's some people that we've gotten like some cooperation from, but we don't have full permission yet. It's time to knock on their doors again. Please prioritize these new things that people have been asking for, all kinds of stuff. So it is, you're right, it's absolutely an ongoing process. And I know from a fan perspective, the idea is, well, if Rocksmith came to you, why wouldn't you say yes? And that could fill up an entirely different stream because everybody has their own reasons. So in any case, let's do one more song. We have not done Shining Star. That's the third song in the Earth, Wind, and Fire pack. Stone cold funk classic, no way around it. Like somebody, oh, this is R&B and this feels a little disco and stuff. Did you guys bring your Egyptian outfits? I figured we would do the last one. We would do the Earth, Wind, and Fire stage show.
That we'd come out of the pyramid.
Yeah,
with the smoke.
That would be fantastic. If there's smoke in this studio, it probably means the PC has set itself on fire because it's a petulant child and it hates me. But there's still hope for Liberace, says Bitspiel. That's right. There's not a lot of hope, but there's still hope for Liberace. I never want to crush anybody's dreams except for Bitspiel's. Every week he goes, Liberace confirmed! And I'm like, okay. Oh, I wish your brother George were here too. So is there something that you'd like to tell us about Shining Star, Greg? Because you were the note tracker on this one.
Yeah, so there's two guitar parts. The rhythm one is the one I'm going to play, and it's the most prominent one. It's just a strummy chord thing. It's fun. But there is like a short solo in the lead part, but the rest of the lead is like kind of what Brian was playing earlier, like super single note, difficult funk stuff. It's great, but this is probably more entertaining for the folks at home.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Folks at home, this is for folks your benefit. So we'll play the song, and then, of course, we will have another giveaway from Ernie Ball right after this. We have our guitar pack to give away. So if you're still hanging in there waiting for your chance to win something, you still have another chance to win something. Don't worry. But in the meantime, I'll try to clean up some of the remaining questions. And, of course, you guys will play, and I will try not to distract you too much. If you're coming in super late, this is Brendan West. He's the guy that does all of our tone stuff, and he is an expert bassist. And he will show you now by playing Shining Star by Earth, Wind, and Fire. Thanks for joining us. And let's do it. Earth, Wind, and Fire available now on all platforms, because while we were away, we got news that the Xbox One has this DLC now. So if you were waiting for it, good news, it's finally available, and thanks for your patience. Sometimes technical things, they happen. And who are you going to call? Cork70 asks, Dan, how was your trip? I went to Seattle last week for PAX. I was hoping to see even more Rocksmith fans, but I did get a couple of thumbs up for my t-shirt. It was a good trip. So much fun.
Wow.
I love all these people in the chat saying, this thing confirmed, and this thing confirmed, and I don't know, I think it's just wishful thinking. I'm here to deconfirm all of your confirmations. He's playing a five-string bass because he owns a five-string bass, and he likes it. One of the questions we get fairly often is, when are you guys going to support five-string bass or seven-string guitar or eight-string guitar? We have no plans to do that in 2014 in the existing product. Maybe in the future, if we get the chance to do it, that would be a conversation we'd have. But consider how many people start playing guitar or bass with those advanced instruments. It's very few. Most people are approaching a six-string guitar and a four-string bass. So that's why all of our tracks are built for that, because that's what the majority of new players play and what the majority of music is recorded on. But we do know that people are moving forward. Once they get the basics to Rocksmith, they want to stick with Rocksmith as they move on to advanced concepts like five-string bass and seven-string guitar. So we're not ignorant of your requests, but we don't have any plans right now to do it in Rocksmith 2014. Pardon? That's true. We have a five-string bass in the office, and Brian Pody says it's at his desk, and that low B is very lonely. I know, but just think of how much wear and tear you save. Very good numbers, too, 93 and 96. Not that we keep count. You know, you can be a musician without getting 100%. We don't care.
That's
not You're going to be a superstar. I don't know which one of you that's about, but I'm assuming it's both. Yeah.
Clearly. Yeah, man, that song is tough, that syncopation.
It's funny because I'm looking at it, I'm like, oh yeah, he's nailing it. Okay, I should probably try this when I get off the stream, because if Brennan's doing it great, it doesn't look that hard, and he's playing it so smoothly, and oh yeah, you have several more years bass experience than I do. Yeah, I think that's probably what it is.
It's a tough song. It's very specific, but really good riffs, especially.
I love that part.
Yeah.
It's very so solid.
Right.
Excellent. Hey, let's do that last giveaway, because I'm starting to get tired. We've been broadcasting for a little bit longer than normal due to our technical difficulties, but this is what you can win now. It's the regular Slinky and M-Steel Slinky Pack. You'll get everything that you see here. The difference between those two strings is that the M-Steels are cobalt-wrapped, so they have a wider... They have a... Yeah, Daddy-O. They have a... They have a wider dynamic range, and they also are less likely to be fatigued, which I'm happy to say. So if you'd like to try out the M-Steels, if you win this pack, you will get to. Plus, of course, Wonder Wipes to keep your guitar shiny and fresh, and moisturize your fretboard and clean your strings and all kinds of good maintenance things that you should all be doing. Plus, a brand new strap, because it's always good to have a spare one of those. A dozen Ernie ball picks, three of our very rare Rocksmith picks, and a peg winder to make those string changes all the easier. All this can be yours if you win the raffle that Black Widow 9 is currently doing. Remember that if you win, you have to send us your name, your address, and your phone number, just so that we can hand that over to the shipping company, so that if something gets lost in transit, which has happened before... No, please, keep going. Don't stop. Well, it would be great if you would do it in the same key, Greg. That would be wonderful. Mr. Jazz over there. So good luck to that, to you on our raffles. If you didn't win this week, don't forget tomorrow on Twitter, we'll be giving away some more Earth, Wind, and Fire codes. Follow Twitter at Ubisoft Studio SF. That's the studio's official Twitter account. And we'll be dropping a few of those throughout the day. No specific times, but it's generally... like a good 12-hour swath or so, and we set them up and we knock them down. If you have any questions for us, you can also write to us on Twitter at Ubisoft Studio SF. Also, you can reach out to at Rocksmith Game. And of course, if you're having any problems with the game, if you have like, hey, my Windows 10 doesn't recognize my sound card, or I noticed that I'm having trouble with detection issues, or I can't find real tone cables in my area, or whatever your issue may be, feel free to reach out to at Ubisoft Support. We really do have experts signed up, and they staff that, and they are there to try to help you. So please reach out to them and use them for the resource that they are. If you are wondering what's coming up for future DLC, I see what you're doing out of my lazy eye. I've got a direct line, man. I can see that you're detuning and you're going to start doing something hilarious. Go ahead. Do it.
That's no,
it.
We're good. We're done.
No,
that's
you're
the end
not.
Of the song.
McCune put you up to this, didn't he? He loves torturing me. He's kind of the ringleader. If you'd like to know what DLC is coming out, say, next week, the best place to go to find out would be in our forums, because I haven't done anything on this, but I guess I'll have to come up with a puzzle really fast to give you a hint as to what's coming next week. So if you're interested in the little insider info, only you guys know, go to the Rocksmith forums, rocksmith.com, and go into the DLC area and look for the Dan's Clue threads. And in fact, if you'd like to try to reverse engineer some of the existing DLC and see how people put together the clues from previous weeks, that's a great way to waste time and make it look like you're working when you're really not. So I'm Dan Amrick. I'm the community developer for Rocksmith 2014. Thank you so much for tuning in and joining us. Thank you, Greg Barr. Thank you to everybody. And thank you so much to Brennan West for coming all the way from your house/studio/home, which, by the way, I looked at an apartment literally across the street from where you live. And when I realized that you lived there, I looked somewhere else.
Yeah,
so
that's wise.
Yeah, that was.
And I'm going to live there.
Yeah.
Yeah, you should. Oh, that would be great. So we'll be back next week, same bat time, same bat channel. Thank you so much. Spread the word. Let everybody know that we're doing this stream. It's always great to meet new people. And if you have any further questions, just send it to all the places that are down there on our Twitch page. And we love hearing from you guys. And thanks so much for your support. We will leave you with another look at the Earth, Wind, and Fire trailer. This is the material that's available now on all platforms. Hopefully you've been inspired to go out and open your heart to Earth, Wind, and Fire and open your wallet to Ubisoft. See you guys next week. Have a good one. Truly.